When we make a genomic library, we're really cloning large pieces of DNA that will eventually represent an entire genome, which means we're not merely looking at the transcripts in the form of cDNAs, we're actually looking at the genes that would have produced those transcripts. So we need to talk a little bit about genomic libraries, the making of which is the art of cloning very large pieces of DNA. So here's how it's done. First of all, you extract total DNA from cells under conditions where you make very high molecular weight genomic DNA. Now, this is a bit of a trick in itself. You may recall that one of the reasons that Rosalind Franklin was able to make beautiful X-ray crystallographs of DNA that Watson and Crick used to decipher the structure of DNA, it was the fact that Maurice Wilkins had developed a way to extract very highly purified, large, high molecular weight DNA. So obviously, since it took a while, a few decades, to increasingly be able to purify big molecules of DNA, you can imagine that we need to take special care in extracting DNA to ensure that it will be high molecular weight. At that point, all you have to do is cut it with your favorite restriction endonuclease and mix it with bacteriophage DNA. As it happens, it's engineered DNA from bacteriophage with compatible sticky ends, meaning cut with the same restriction endonuclease. The bacteriophage DNA in this case will be the vector, the carrier, that's going to take the recombinant insert genomic DNA into cells where it will multiply. I did not use the term vector to describe the plasmids in cDNA cloning, but indeed, plasmids are also vectors in cloning. So a common terminology for cloning is the vector. The vector is the phage or the plasmid, which is going to carry a recombinant insert that you're actually going to study. So we mix these two together, and again, we get, if we do it right in the presence of DNA ligase, we get recombinant phage. Each again will have a different insert. Now these are very much larger fragments of DNA that can be inserted into a recombinant phage compared to cDNAs. Just to give you an idea, if a cDNA is 300 to 500 nucleotides long, representing a messenger RNA of about that length, recombinant phage can carry pieces of DNA that are 20 or even 22, 23,000 base pairs long. So you can get huge chunks of the genome into recombinant phage. And that's important because if you're going to screen a library of genomic inserts, there's much more DNA than there is RNA in sheer length that you're going to have to screen unless you can put big pieces into your recombinants. And that's what's happening here. So you have these recombinant phage DNA, now you would like to get them into cells. How is that done? Well, that relies on studies that were done in which phage were actually ripped apart. The protein coats were taken apart, the DNA was studied, the protein was studied. And in the course of doing this, it was shown possible to take the DNA of phage and the proteins you extracted and to recombine those and reconstitute an infectious phage. So all we have to do after we make our recombinants is to buy off the shelf, or the equivalent of going to the pharmacy, and buying viral proteins with which you can package your DNA into active infectious phage. So we add purified bacteriophage coat proteins, and you get infectious recombinant viruses, as it says here. This is, I hope, a bit of a reminder of what happens when phage infects cells, and at the same time, what's actually going to happen when you take these recombinant phage. So crudely drawn here is a phage particle, a bacteriophage, in which there is a circular DNA molecule that you have packaged. You have taken recombinant phage, the red is the insert, the black is the original phage DNA. It is circular, and it has been packaged into a phage particle that's infectious. So when it actually gloms onto, say, an E. coli cell, the infection can proceed. So let's see what happens. The circular molecule of DNA is what gets into the cell. That circular molecule is ready to be replicated, and the replication of these phage produces linear DNA molecules that do not circularize. So the new phage that are about to be made in this cell are going to be packaged in the cell with newly translated phage coat proteins as linear DNA in this fashion. So the cell replicates loads and loads of viruses. Now, this infected cell is doomed. When the cell gets chock-a-block full of these viral particles, each one containing linearized phage DNA with one or another insert, they're going to lyse the cell. They're going to burst the cell open, and out come the phage. So what happens in a petri dish when you do this is you actually have a lawn of bacteria shown here as a bright yellow onto which you have poured some of these phage that you have packaged. And what will happen is what you saw on the last slide to each cell that gets infected, and then the phage that are released go in and infect the adjacent cells. And this process just keeps happening until what is a lawn of bacterial cells is peppered with clear spots representing burst open or lysed cells. And these are called plaques. Each plaque will be derived from a single phage that happened to land on the lawn of bacteria, infect one cell, and then progressively infect cells around that one cell until you got a clearing in the lawn of E. coli cells on this plate. At this point, we'll do things that are very like what we did in cDNA cloning. Before I go on, I should say that each plaque represents a single recombinant molecule of DNA that was in that original virus. And so if you have enough plaques, enough different plaques, you have what's called a representative genomic library. You have a library containing ultimately virtually all of the genomic fragments that you could generate by doing this kind of cloning. So now the question is, which plaque contains viruses with a recombinant globin gene? If we follow up on our isolating a globin cDNA, we can use that globin cDNA as a probe to isolate a globin gene. So that's what our hybridization probe will be. It won't be a small synthetic oligonucleotide made radioactive because, as it turns out, very small fragments of DNA like that, 15 to 25 or 30 bases, do not effectively find targets in large DNA fragments. So what you can use is the whole globin cDNA instead, which is perhaps 20, 30, 40 times as big. And so we've already screened the cDNA library. We have that cDNA for globin. We're going to make it radioactive. So we have a radioactive probe. We make a replica filter of the plaques, which is done very much the same as we did for the colonies when we made the cDNA library. So go back and look at that. What you end up with is a filter replica of the plaque. You soak that in a solution containing the radioactive globin cDNA probe. You wash off the excess and you put the film on. Same process. Later, after exposing, you develop the film and you see if any black spots form that would have been laying over one of the plaques. And here, sure enough, one did. The positive signal then was lying over a plaque that contains phage with a globin gene. You go back to the original dish with plaques, and you can pick a few phage out of the lysed spot and use those to reinfect fresh cells and grow oodles and oodles of globin gene, or GOBs, if you like. And at that point, of course, you have many options, one of which, of course, is to sequence the entire gene. The first time this was done, in fact, using a globin gene, the structure of an intron was revealed. Remember that globin genes and other eukaryotic genes are split genes. They are composed of exons and introns, the exons being the coding regions, the introns being the non-coding regions. We knew this from hybridization experiments using electron microscopy. But the very first time the globin gene had been isolated and sequenced, you could actually see the sequence of an intron. In fact, the sequence of the two introns that are found in most globin genes. So that brings us to the end of this module, which was mainly to give you a flavor of cloning large fragments of DNA, which allows us to create a library of all the genes in an organism. Each clone, by the way, is going to have not one or two genes, but probably dozens, if not sometimes hundreds of genes in a single fragment. And what you'll be doing when you probe for a particular gene is trying to find the fragment which has perhaps several dozen genes on it, but included in that several dozen genes is the one you're looking for.